Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome. I'm glad to be together again virtually. And our first hymn is by Isaac Watts, who was one of the earliest nonconformist hymn writers. In those days, every people sang the Psalms, and they weren't that keen on any singing that wasn't Psalms. And what Isaac Watts did was to take some of the Psalms, and he would recognize that they're praise to God, but they're Old Testament, and he would blend the Christian message into them. And you see this happening in this psalm about coming to the it's a psalm of rejoicing as the Jewish people went up to Jerusalem to the temple to worship, and of course, Zion, through hymns like this, Zion has become symbolic of a Christian place of worship as well, and in fact, a symbol of the whole Christian church. As when we sing glorious things of thee are spoken, Zion, city of our God, it's the whole church we're talking about, and so we're going to sing that now. It's a hymn. It's always been one of my favorite hymns, actually. It's about the pleasure and the gladness of coming together for worship. How pleased and blessed was I. It doesn't seem to have sound. So just as the ancient Israelites thousands of years ago rejoiced to come to their temple, so the followers of Christ all over the world are gathering today, especially today, the Lord's Day, the first day of the week. They're gathering in great cathedrals and churches, surrounded by lots of splendid and beautiful treasures, wonderful pictures and statues and architecture, gathering for Orthodox liturgy or for Roman Catholic Mass, or they're gathering in great big auditoriums to listen to great sermons in large congregations. Some are meeting in small, quiet gatherings. And some of them are meeting in places of war and violence, desperately seeking God's help. They've come together to pray because they really feel the need of it. And some of them are in places of poverty, where, unlike us better off people, they boost their faith with lots of singing and dancing often. And often the worship of poor people is much more joyful than the worship of rich people. I wonder why. And some of them, of course, are in places of persecution where they have to hide and worship silently and be very careful about who sees them going into the place of worship. So let's think of them and pray for worshippers all over the world. We thank you, God, that as we gather here, we are in a great assembly of people all over the world, assembling in different ways. And here we are in this new, fairly new and unusual way of not being together in person, but nevertheless together in our communication. And let's think about why we come. We celebrate this, the Lord's Day. We come because Jesus is alive and active in the world, and we want to celebrate it. We come to think again about the gospel, the good news, and what it means for us and what it means for the world. We come to find our faith and hope reinforced, and to open ourselves to the challenge of being disciples. And we come to support one another, to show our care for one another, to meet with one another as friends, to express our love for one another. Jesus said, "Where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." Thank you, God, for gathering us together in your presence. May the blessing of this special time overflow into every part of our life. And we say together the prayer that our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Now we have two readings. One is from Genesis about God creating a people for himself and for the world. And the other is about practical issues in the life of that people centuries later. And is Vivian? Ah, Vivian has managed to get you. I see. And you're doing the reading. Yeah. Can't see you, not hear you.
I take it Vivian isn't here. Do you want me to do it, Ray?
Yes, perhaps you better get, yes, yeah. Sorry, Vivian, we seem to have got stuck again. Right, Marilyn, yeah.
Genesis chapter 12, and I'm reading verses 1, 2, and 3. God's call to Abraham. The Lord said to Abraham, "Leave your country, your relatives, and your father's home, and go to a land that I am going to show you. I will give you many descendants, and they will become a great nation. I will bless you and make your name famous, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, but I will curse those who curse you. And through you, I will bless all the nations. The second reading is Matthew chapter 18, reading verses 15 to 20. If your brother sins against you, go to him and show him his fault. But do it privately, just between yourselves. If he listens to you, you have won the brother back. But if he will not listen to you, take one or two other persons with you, so that every accusation may be upheld by the testimony of two or more witnesses. As the scripture says, and if he will not listen to them, then tell the whole thing to the church. Finally, if he will not listen to the church, treat him as though he were a pagan or a tax collector. And so I tell all of you, what you prohibit on earth will be prohibited in heaven, and what you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. And I tell you more, whenever two of you on earth agree about anything you pray for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three come together in my name, I am there with them.
This passage from Matthew, it seems fairly obvious to me, was not literally said by Jesus himself, certainly not the whole of it, because it reflects a situation where there is a church that meets together and where there are sort of procedures for doing things in the church. And so this is, in a way, this is Matthew interpreting the teaching of Jesus, getting into the spirit of Jesus and talking about practical ways of doing things here and now. But it says something about the power of the church. What you prohibit on earth will be prohibited in heaven. And what you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. There's a tremendous power there, and that's been used and misused down through the ages. We think of the dictatorial power of priests and in the past, and the ability of priests to pronounce forgiveness of sins or to refuse it. And people have trembled against in face of that power. We think of the power to administer communion or to refuse it. And one of the biggest punishments at one time was that people should be excommunicated, because to be excommunicated meant you couldn't take the body and blood of Christ and you had no hope of going to heaven. And of course, there have often been huge power struggles in the history of the church. There have been wars. Some of the creeds that we think of as being the good summary of the Christian faith were argued over and even at times fought over, literally, in wars. And there have been other struggles, power struggles ever since, and still are in many of the churches. Wars fought in the name of religion, all because of this idea that the church is a powerful institution. And the controversies we have today between people who believe that they're absolutely right and persecute those who are wrong, heresies, heretics. People in many cultures, and we remember it, I'm sure, in our own time, lived in fear of the church. They were in fear of ministers and deacons and elders and all the church authorities, afraid that if they put a foot wrong, they would be condemned. And we see the extreme of it, some of these cults, where there's one leader who controls the whole life of his flock, who tells them where they should work, who they should marry, what they should wear, and all sorts of things. There's been a lot of power in the churches, and I'm sure you can think of examples of that. Have any of you had examples of it in your own life experience, or of people you know, of the rather oppressive power of the church? Well, I'm sure you can think of examples, and if you haven't experienced them yourself, you're very fortunate. But you've probably heard about them and read about them. And all these things can make us feel that power and true Christianity don't go together, that the church should not be powerful. Jesus died on the cross. He gave up power. He didn't fight to survive and to defend himself. He gave up power. And yet, there are hints that there was a sense of the church having power. This passage that we've just read, and just look back two chapters into Matthew 16, you find Jesus saying the words to Peter, "On this rock I will build my church. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And what you prohibit on earth will be prohibited in heaven. And what you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven." And from this idea, of course, we get the idea of Peter being the one who decides whether or not people can be let into heaven. He has the keys of the kingdom. And of course, the belief in the apostolic succession, that the Pope is the successor of Peter, and the Pope has the power to say what is right and what is wrong. And when the Pope makes a declaration that something is right, it's right. And when the Pope makes a declaration that something is wrong, it's wrong. And we as Protestants have rebelled against that. And then not only in Matthew's Gospel, but in John as well, you have this strange story of how Jesus appeared to the disciples on the Sunday evening, the day of the resurrection. And having given them his peace, he said to them, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive people's sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." And so you have these several passages that point to the idea that somewhere in the church, in the apostles or the descendants of the apostles or whatever, there is the authority to allow or to prohibit, and that authority counts universally in heaven. Not just our idea, but we can make it right in heaven if we make it right on earth. And can we break up into little groups now for a while and discuss, well, what do you think these passages mean? How do you think they apply in the church today? In the free churches and Baptists and Congregationalists and others, we've taken it together from this passage that the church is not popes or bishops or priests. The church is wherever two or three people are gathered together in the name of Jesus. The authority belongs to the church. In this passage we read from Matthew, it has to be exercised in a gentle way. It's not somebody getting on their high horse and saying, "You must not do this, this is wrong," or "You're okay with this, this is right." It's not making a sort of ex cathedra statement that applies to everybody. It must be done in a gentle way. First, you get together with a person you think is doing wrong, and you talk about it privately. There's so much vociferous argument today, people condemning one another and so on, calling them heretics, calling them sinners, and all the rest of it. And it's just vociferous argument. But this text says, do it between yourselves privately. If you have something against the person, go to them and talk with them privately. And then if they won't cooperate, then take two or three other people with you, so that there are two or three witnesses. And if they still won't cooperate, take it to the whole church. We interpret that as Baptists, we interpret that as the church meeting. And if they won't listen to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. Now, that sounds like excommunicating them, doesn't it? Pushing them out. But just think, how did Jesus treat pagans and tax collectors? He still loves them, and loves them especially, in fact. And so people who are doing wrong and won't listen to anybody else, they're not people to push out of our lives altogether. They are people who call for our compassion and our love. And in some way, we've got to express that love. And so it goes on to say, wherever two of you agree on earth about anything you pray for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. Where two or three come together in my name, I am there with them. So the power doesn't come from the throne of a pope or a bishop or a priest, but from Christians together, wherever they are, and however many or however few they are. And the power is to be exercised in a gentle and brotherly manner. But beyond all this, I think there's a deeper message about what the church is. You know, we talk about the church as the body of Christ. We should take that seriously. We are Christ in the world today. We are continuing the ministry of Christ. As some people have said, he has no hands but our hands, no feet but our feet, no lips but our lips in the world today. And so we, in a sense, are representing Jesus in the world. And the work that Jesus came to do has been handed over to us. And he's in the world through us. And that gives us power. At the same time, it gives us a very serious and rather a frightening responsibility. Because what we say is heard as if it's God's word. There are some who dismiss it and say, oh, well, Christians say that, the church says that, but, you know, we don't believe that. But lots of people are influenced by what the church, the Christian churches say and what Christian people say. And many people who are condemned by the church are quite convinced that they are condemned by God, because the church says so. And the sort of people we are give people the impression of who God is. So many people have been put off the churches and been put off God because they've been put off the churches. They think, well, that's what God is saying in the world and doing in the world, and we don't want anything to do with it. If we make people feel inferior or unworthy, they may well end up believing that God thinks them inferior and unworthy. If we make them feel accepted and loved, they will feel through us the love of God. And it works the other way as well. If we speak up about what's something that's wrong, then it touches people's conscience. And it may be that something will be done about it. There are times when we have to say, this is wrong. We speak up against racism and prejudice and greed and inequality and cruelty and all those sort of things. It's our job as representatives of Christ in the world to speak up against those things. And the more we speak up against them, the more our word will be accepted, or at least heard as the word of God. And if people know that they have done wrong, and we show them forgiveness and help them to a new way of life, it's easier for them to feel that God is with them, forgiving them, and leading them on into a new way of life. And many people despair about making any difference to the world. And often we look at it that way. We see all the terrible problems in the world, and we say, oh, well, nothing can be done about them, no. And if we say that, that gives the impression to lots of other people that even God isn't doing anything about them. But if churches are seen, and if Christian people are seen to be standing up and trying to do something about the evils in the world, that is an encouragement to others. So we do have power in the church. As the church, we have power. Not the power to boss people about, but the power to represent God. And for many people, that is important. There are many people who believe that they are condemned because the church condemns them. They don't just rebel against it and say, oh, the church is wrong. They feel condemned. People like gay and lesbian, transgender people and so on. Other people who are doing things that are frowned upon by certain people. The fact that churches condemn them makes them feel condemned and inferior and unworthy. And if churches welcome people and support them and love them, then that helps them to feel welcomed and supported and loved by God. And in the end, it's God who knows what's right and what's wrong. But it's we who, in a sense, have the power to help people in the world to see what's right and what's wrong, and to experience the nature of God, because we are the body of Christ in the world. And that, I think, is the real power of the church. And often we exercise it unconsciously. We don't realize we're doing it. But the things we say, especially if we're known as Christians, as members of the Christian church, the things we say and do are what the world sees of God and knows of God very often. It's a great responsibility, but when we do it right, it's a great privilege. And to me, that is, I think, and they're very difficult passages, but that, I think, is what those passages are about. So now we'll sing a hymn that expresses that, is "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace." The church is a channel of the peace and the love of God. Make me a channel of your peace. We couldn't see the words, but most of us probably know it by heart, and I'm sure we were joining in our minds, if not singing along with it. Now let's pray. Let's confess before God our divisions in the church and the inept way that we often deal with them, our mistrust and suspicion of one another. And let's confess our lack of faith and our failure to tell the world the good news, that we are often so bogged down with other things, the secondary things, that we don't make plain what the good news of God's love is and what it means to the world. And let's confess our failure often to live what we preach and what we profess to believe. Our God, we thank you that you use us in spite of our faults and our weaknesses. You're still able to use some of the smallest things we do and say to spreading your good news in the world. And Jesus said, whenever two of you on earth agree about anything you pray for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. So let's, in the faith of that, pray about those for whom we are particularly concerned today. We think of those close to us, our loved ones, our family, our friends, any who are in particular need today. That we're praying for people further away. We pray for those close to us. We pray for people further away, for the victims of the earthquake in Morocco. And for refugees, whether in other countries or those trying to get into this country, the terrible situation of people who lose their lives often by trying to escape from oppression and persecution or from poverty. Let's pray for wisdom and compassion in the governments of the world, that we may build a better world instead of complaining about this one. And let's pray for our church in its coming months, in the changes that we will be going through. Jesus said, those who believe in me will do what I do. Yes, they will do even greater things because I'm going to the Father. If you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. So let's dare to pray about the big things, to pray for an end to war and poverty, to pray about the injustice of our society and of the world, the great mountains that seem so unconquerable. Let's pray that God will help our faith, help our unbelief, and increase our faith, that we may, even starting very small, that we may do something to change these big evils in the world. We thank you, God, that you hear our prayers. You hear the prayers we say out loud and the prayers we are silent about, and even the prayers we cannot put into words. Your Spirit interprets our longings and our desires and knows what we want and what we need. And we trust in you, God, to care for us and to bless us. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now we sing the hymn, Go Forth and Tell. Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Show love to everyone. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Now we break up into groups for a little chat before coming back for the final blessing.